So, I'm recording it also, don't talk.
Oops.
So, we are going to start fluid dynamics. Please write it down. Okay. So, in fluid statics, we focus primarily with which property of the fluid? Pressure. Okay, why? Because that is where most of the time, that is what is used most of the time. For example, you have to build a dam. Okay, suppose you are one of those engineers who is building a dam. So you must know what is the amount of pressure the fluid can exert on the dam. Then only you will build the dam accordingly. Okay? And you must know how much pressure is there as you go down a static fluid. Otherwise you don't know how will you build a submarine, for example, or how much below a human being can go inside. Alright, so in order to understand all these things, I must know how is the pressure variation in a static fluid. Fine, so in the fluid, our focus was majorly talking about pressure itself. Okay, in fact, the buoyant force that we have discussed, yes or no? Right, in the buoyant force itself is nothing but an outcome of the pressure variation itself. Fine. So our major focus was pressure, alright, and then when we studied the solids, what was our major focus? What was our focus? When we studied the solid, our focus was the strength of the solid. Oh, you are our student only. Alright. So, when we studied the solid, our focus was the strength of solid. How it will break, when it will break, with what stress it will break. Why we are focusing that property of the solid? Because solid is used in building structures. Right? So, I must know how much load I can give to a solid. So, we are focusing on that property of solid when we have properties of solid chapters. But when we have properties of fluids, we don't focus on strength of fluid. I am not going to build pillars from the fluid. Okay? But there will be scenarios like building dams and so, you will be probably building the submarines. So you must know how the pressure will vary, and because of that pressure variation, what all things can happen. Fine? So that was our prime focus when we had fluid statics in the question. Now we are moving forward. Okay, we are going to talk about the physical properties of fluid when it is flowing. What is the difference between flow and a motion? You can take a bucket of water and run with it. The fluid is not flowing. Okay, fluid is at rest only. So fluid statics will be applied there. Alright, when I say flow, have you discussed this flow thing already? Okay. So when you take a solid and you apply a shear force like this, what happens to the solid? Solid will get deformed like this. There will be angle of deformation like that. Shear strain will be there. Right? But when you take a fluid, solid offers some resistance against this external force, and that is what is the shear stress. Okay, whereas the fluid offers no resistance to the shear force. Are you getting the difference? So the shear stress is almost zero in the fluid. It can get deformed indefinitely. So one layer of the fluid can move relative to the other layer of the fluid with a very, very minimal amount of force. Okay, so that is the difference between a solid and a liquid with respect to the flow. The shear deformation is called the flow itself. In fact, if you heat this solid, it will go towards the liquid. Its behavior will tend towards the liquid's behavior or the fluid behavior. Fine. So this is called the flow. All right. But we are not going to use this technical definition whenever we study the fluid property when water is flowing. So just like in the previous case, whenever fluid was flowing, we were making buckets. Now when we have to discuss the flow of the water, what will be drawing? A pipe. Usually water is flowing, the fluid is flowing inside the pipe only, right? So that is how we will represent a water that is flowing. A pipe will be drawn, a portion of a pipe will be drawn, and water is flowing inside it, okay? Now, when I talk about fluid dynamics, what do you think the kind of properties I am looking for? Velocity. Why I am interested in the velocity of the fluid? Okay. Why? Okay. He is saying type of the flow. Do you understand what does this mean? Type of flow. Okay. Correct. You know it. So for example, if you open the tap of the water in your home, when you open it lightly, then a very smooth flow happens. Okay? When you open it completely, the behavior of the flow changes. Right? So that is turbulent behavior. Okay? It so happens that the same fluid, when the flow is laminar, the property is different. And the flow, when it becomes turbulent, the property completely changes. Have you ever encountered turbulence when you are in a flight? Okay, so when you are in a flight, if there is no turbulence, you will be going very smoothly, and your aircraft is designed for the laminar flow. But when the flow changes to turbulent, same air which was letting the aircraft go smoothly, suddenly the aircraft will drop by 100 meters. So property has changed just because the flow is changed, right? So when I talk about fluid dynamics, I need to study the property of the fluid when there is a laminar flow or a smooth flow, and then I have to discuss the property of fluid when it is a turbulent flow separately. Okay? Now luckily in your class 11th, turbulent flow is not there. Although it is there just to find out whether the flow is laminar or turbulent, but we are not discussing the property of the fluid flow in detail when the flow is turbulent. Fine. So our focus is property of the fluid flow when the flow is laminar. Are you getting it? Okay, when it is smoothly flowing. We are going to discuss what is this laminar or smooth flow, what it does it mean and how you can find out. But having said that, let's talk further about what do you mean by property of, or let's say fluid dynamics, what are kind of property? That is one property we need to find out is what kind of flow it is, because the property itself depends on which flow it is. What else we will be finding out here? What do you think? We are right now assuming it to be non-viscous. Okay? What do you think? Someone said velocity. Why I need to find the velocity? What is the reason? Why I need to find the velocity of the flow? Because if water is flowing with some velocity, it will have some momentum also. It can hit some object and that can start moving. For example, have you heard of hydropower plants? What happens there? A turbine is there. On the turbine, water comes and hits and turbine rotates. And that turbine is connected to the AC generator's coil, and then with turbine the coil also rotates, and that is how you generate the power in hydropower plants. Fine. So you should know what is the velocity of the water, otherwise you will not be able to control the motion of the turbine. Yes or no? Right. So one is knowing the velocity, then you know the momentum, and then you know what kind of force water can exert on the turbine. That is just an example. What do you think the other property could be? Energy. Now we have learned work energy theorem in work power energy chapter. Yes or no? Now when we have we have derived the verb energy theorem, we have never said that this theorem is valid only for solids, only for gas, or only for liquids. That is a universal theorem. It is valid everywhere. But the problem is, with the fluid, applying verb energy theorem is tricky. Why it is tricky? Because you take a pipe, water is continuously coming in and going. When you write half mv square, which mass you will take? Infinite amount of mass will come in, let's say 5 hours, so much mass is coming and going. So continuously, how you write half mv square? Which mass it is? Are you getting it? And similarly, when we talk about potential energy, mgh, and pipe is supposed vertical like this, clearly the water here has more potential energy than water there. What is flowing like that? But how will you write mgh? Which mass you will take here? Are you getting it? So the work energy format for this solid is such that it is inconvenient to apply in fluids. So we need to modify that work energy theorem so that it becomes convenient for us to apply work energy theorem here. And when you do that, the equation that will come out is Bernoulli's theorem. Okay, so Bernoulli's theorem is nothing but application of work energy theorem in the fluid itself. Alright, now here when I have taken the example of pipe, I have just told you that water is continuously coming and going. Alright, and I don't know which mass to consider. Now that kind of difficulty is not there with solids. Why? Because entire solid remains as a single object. Fine. So you need not worry about the. What are you talking? Bol na, kya tha, baat kar raha hai. Question. Usko puch raha hai. Puch na sawal. Arey? Kya later? Puch. Okay. So what I was saying was that when it comes to solid, you don't need to worry about the conservation of mass, because the entire solid remains as it is, and single intact object, mass m is given. But here the problem is, the mass is continuously coming in and going. Alright? So I should not go against the conservation of mass. Somehow I have to apply the concept of conservation of mass in fluid also. It should not happen that I am assuming 5 kg is coming from here and at the same time 20 kg is going out from the pipe. That is against the conservation of mass, right? So the equation that will come out from the conservation of mass is called continuity equation. Fine. So we are going to discuss these two theorems only, continuity theorem and Bernoulli's theorem, when we talk about fluid dynamics. And fluid dynamics is much more simpler than fluid statics. Even though the situation is little bit more involved, the fluid is no longer static, it is moving. But when you solve the problem, you will realize that the problems of fluid dynamics are much simpler. Okay, so let us start that. Okay, please write down first, since we are talking about the fluid property, when the flow is streamlined, let us first discuss what is streamlined flow. Okay, so please write down streamlined flow, we will discuss that. Okay, as the name streamlined suggests, there has to be some sort of line. Okay, so suppose you have a particle. This is nothing but the path one particle of fluid is following. When entire water may be going, this could be happening inside a pipe. Okay, inside a big pipe, lot of fluid particles might be there. Many fluid particles, infinite fluid particles are there. Okay. But the definition of streamline flow comes from the motion of a single particle. Okay, let's say one such particle out of those infinite particles follows this path. It goes from point 1 to point 2 and it follows this path. Okay, The streamline flow is a flow, okay, for which the each particle, if it enters point number one, it will follow the same path and will reach the point two also. Okay, so path between the two points is fixed. Are you getting it? That is what the streamline flow is. If somehow a particle comes and touches this streamline, it is going to follow this path. Okay? Is this in clear? So in a streamline flow, the path of a particle is fixed from a given point. Okay? Now tell me, how you determine the direction of flow? Direction of flow is along the streamline, yes or no? Right? So please write down tangent to the streamline. Tangent to the streamline is the direction of flow. Okay? So if I know the streamline, which streamline it is, I can just draw the tangent and I can tell you at this point the direction of flow is this. Okay? Simple? Alright? Now streamline gives you more information than just telling you about the direction of flow. Okay? Let us see how. For example, if you take, suppose you have a streamline like this, can two streamlines intersect? Reason? Suppose they intersect at point A, two streamlines intersect, then what does it mean? I can draw two tangents at point A, tangent to this streamline and tangent to that streamline. So which velocity it is? A particle cannot have two velocities at a particular point. So if they intersect, you will have two tangents along the two streamlines. Okay, which is against the definition of streamline itself. Fine? So that is why two streamlines will never intersect. Alright? Okay? How do you think turbulent flow might be happening? There is no unique path when it comes to turbulent flow. A particle might be going like this. Similar particle starting from here could follow a different path. Okay, so there is no fixed path. The intermixing is so much. Okay, you can't determine the path of a particle in a turbulent flow. Okay, so you cannot have any scientific theory as such to describe the turbulent flow. The most of the study in turbulent flow is statistical. You just observe and then correlate. Okay, I have observed this earlier, so if such kind of scenario again happens, then this is what will happen. Such kind of study will be there in turbulent flow. Not in our syllabus, you don't need to worry about it. Just I thought I could tell you, since we were discussing about laminar, so turbulent flow also. Now, I was talking about the information given by the streamline flow. So suppose this is a pipe. Clearly this is bigger cross section, this is bigger and that is smaller. And this is not the entire pipe, by the way. Every time I draw a pipe, I am not drawing the entire pipe. It is a part of a bigger pipe. Fine. Don't confuse with that this is the entire pipe. No. Okay. Now, if I draw a streamline starting from here, then this will be there. Now, there are infinite particles, right? So I can draw those many number of streamlines. Now, tell me one thing. Where do you think the velocity of the fluid is more? Here, at A2 velocity is more, okay, and at A2 number of the streamline per unit area is also more, density of streamline is more, okay, so density of streamline gives you an indication of the magnitude of the velocity. Please write down that the number of streamline per unit area, number of streamlines per unit area is proportional to number of streamlines per unit area is proportional to the magnitude of the velocity. So now using streamline, I found out the direction as well as magnitude. Got it? Okay. So this is what the streamline flow is. We are not going to go back to the definition of streamline flow going forward. Alright? Any doubts on the definition of streamline flow, what it is? No? Okay. Now let us try to apply those two concepts that we have discussed initially. One was conservation of mass, another was work energy theorem. Alright? So let us take it one by one. First, I will apply conservation of mass. Write down. Conservation of mass in fluid dynamics is also referred as continuity equation or continuity theorem. Okay? Alright, so here is a pipe, let us say. This cross-section area is, let's say, A1, and that cross-section area is, let's say, A2. Okay? Now, other parameter also given. It's a part of a bigger pipe, by the way. Other parameters are given like this. The fluid enters with velocity V1 from here, and it goes from here with velocity V2. Achha, I forgot one thing. You guys have got your UT marks, right? I should have started the discussion with that. How many of you, it was out of? How many of you 25? 25! Good. Only one? Okay, how many of you above 20? Are you? Above 20 I am saying. Only two. What happened? Was it difficult? Okay, super girl. Huh? I am asking you, is she human or not? She can do it. So, lot of. It's getting recorded. Anyway, so the paper was difficult, is it? Lengthy. Paper was lengthy. Okay. Okay. And what are the chapters came? Okay. Okay, next physics test, please do well. Alright. Anyways, so this is a scenario, and let's say density of the fluid is rho. Why I am writing density here? Because till now I have been using density and pressure to define the property of the fluid. So I will be using that terminology only. Okay? So this is the situation that is happening. Okay? Now tell me, suppose in 1 second, 1 kg mass goes in 1 second. So in 1 second, how much mass will go out? 1 kg only? No. More than 1 kg will come out.
No, very small.
Okay, wait. How many of you say only 1 kg will come out? Okay, how many of you say more than 1 kg?
Yeah.
7, then what will happen? Lesser mass. Ajay, tell me one thing, guys. Wait. Suppose they are different. Suppose 1 kg is coming in and 3 kg is going out every second. Every second, 2 kg is generated inside the pipe. Is it possible? The pipe generates 2 kg every second. Not possible? Suppose 5 kg goes in and only 1 kg goes out. So inside the pipe, 4 kg is getting stored every second. Is it possible? No. So same 1 kg that is going in, same 1 kg will go out in 1 second. Are you getting it? But what if the pipe is empty? What if pipe is empty? Pipe doesn't have water initially. Then what will happen? Initially nothing will come out. First it will store the water inside the pipe. Once it is full, then whatever comes in from here, it will reject from there. Are you getting it? So we are not talking about the scenario when the pipe is empty. We are talking about that scenario where pipe is completely filled. Okay? And that is the scenario we are going to discuss here. So we have determined that rate of mass that is entering from the left hand side should be equal to the rate of mass that is exiting from the right hand side. Does this make sense? Okay. Now let us say in dt time, dt is a very very small time, right? In dt time, how much the water that is entering from left hand side will travel inside? Velocity into time. Velocity is v1 and time is dt. So distance travel will be v1 dt. Right? So let us say that it travels inside this distance, which is equal to v1 dt. Got it? Now tell me, how much is this mass which has gone inside? What is the mass of that? Ajay, what is the volume of that? Tell me. A1 into V1 dt. It is like a cylinder. It is like a very thin cylinder. The area of cross section into height is the volume. So volume that has entered is area A1 into V1 dt. So mass will be that into rho. That into rho, right? So dm1, which has entered in dt time, is a1 v1 dt into rho. Fine. So I'm getting dm1 by dt is equal to rho a1 v1. So by the way, I am assuming that the fluid is incompressible. Otherwise, density will not remain uniform. Okay? Yes. No, non-viscous we are not assuming here right now. Okay? We are assuming that fluid is incompressible. Write down in the bracket that the assumption is fluid is incompressible. Density remains uniform. Same thing may not be valid for the air. Okay? Now, similarly, suppose V2 is the velocity here. Let's say it goes out, so this much water will go out, so this much distance will be V2 dt, right? The rate of water or the fluid that is coming out is rho into A2 into V2, yes or no? Okay, now these two are equal. The mass that is entering from the left hand side should be equal to mass that is exiting from the right hand side per unit time. Okay, so when you equate these two, you are going to get rho A1 V1 equal to rho A2 V2. This is same as A1 V1 being equal to A2 V2. Okay, got it? Now tell me, where have we used the fact that we are talking only about the laminar flow? Have you used that anywhere? This velocity is an sort of average velocity. Okay? No, no, this is not the particle velocity. Particles may still have a different velocity. This is like an average velocity. We have not used that assumption. So this continuity equation is valid for any kind of flow. Please write down. Continuity equation is valid for any kind of flow. And what if the fluid is compressible? Then
density
will change. So the continuity equation will become rho 1 a1 v1 is equal to rho 2 a2 v2. Fine. If you're taking a compressible fluid, then rho 1 a1 v1 equal to rho 2 a2 v2. Okay. Yes. Any type of flow. Conservation of mass is valid for any kind of flow. Isn't it? Do you think conservation of mass depends on what kind of flow it is? No, right? It should not. Any doubt? Okay, so this is continuity equation. Alright? Now we are getting into the application of work-measure theorem in the fluid dynamics. Okay? Please write down Bernoulli's theorem. Is the spelling correct?
Yeah, L-L-I-S.
For N I
double L I.
Hey, it's correct.
Bernoulli.
Bernoulli. Oh, I. This is I only. But there will be comma as well. So please write down in the brackets that Bernoulli's theorem is nothing but application of work energy theorem in the flowing water or flowing fluid. Okay, now since we are talking about the application of work energy theorem, and most of the time the pipe will be on the earth only. As a rare any pipe is on the moon or just somewhere, right? More than that will be a scenario. So what kind of potential energy we are dealing with? Gravitation potential energy, right? So in order to derive the Bernoulli's theorem, I should not take a horizontal pipe. If I take a horizontal pipe, there is no potential energy difference. Okay, so that term will not come in the equation itself. So rather than taking horizontal, I will be taking inclined one, so that the potential energy term also come in the equation. Now there is a difference in potential energies if pipe is taken like that. Alright, draw this pipe. Ron, stop talking. They're in a straight line. This is height H2. Guys, a word of caution, if you don't pay attention in this derivation, you will never understand it. I have seen it. For past 10 years, I have seen it. If you don't pay attention the first time, you are not going to understand this Bernoulli's theorem. Okay, then you have to rely on your memory to memorize everything and just like a vomiter and forget about it. Okay, I don't want you to do that. Okay, understand how things work so that you don't need to remember or memorize things. This is area of cross section A1. This is A2. Okay? Any doubt? Now, this is a cross section of a bigger pipe. So, I will be drawing a dotted line like this. So, had it been open to the atmosphere, then pressure here would have been same as the atmospheric pressure. But it is not open to the atmosphere. Okay? So, pressure over here is P1. And over there the pressure is P2. Okay, it is incompressible fluid, so density remains constant, rho. Okay, and the velocity with which it is coming from this side is V1, and velocity with which it is going out from there is V2. I need to draw velocity, pressure and everything else because I am going to apply Bernoulli theorem over here and all of these terms will be used there. Any doubts till now? No? Okay, what does Bernoulli theorem says? Keep quiet and tell me. Work done by other forces will be equal to what? U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. It is same thing as saying U2 minus U1 plus K2 minus K1. Yes or no? Same thing? Yes or no? Okay. Now tell me between which two points I am applying the... Before that you tell me on what I am applying Bernoulli theorem. I'm not applying on the entire pipe, right? I'm not applying an infinite mass. On which object I'm applying Bernoulli theorem here? Tell me. On the water that is inside this pipe, which is shown. From this point to that point, the entire water, for that I'm applying Bernoulli theorem. Is it clear? Okay? So first you need to identify on which you are applying Bernoulli theorem. Otherwise, how will you proceed, right? So, I am applying Bernoulli theorem for entire water starting from here to there. Okay, now you need to have point number 1 and point number 2. Between which two points you are applying Bernoulli theorem, right? So, what is that? This point and that point. They are not the two points in time. What I am trying to say is that if you are applying Bernoulli theorem on a sphere and I ask you between which two points you are applying Bernoulli theorem, you are not going to say I am applying Bernoulli theorem from this point to that point of the sphere. Does it make sense? No. If the sphere comes from top and rolls down, then you can say, okay, from this initial position of the sphere to the final position of the sphere, I am applying Bernoulli theorem. Yes or no? Okay, don't get confused by 1 or 2 written here. Rather than 1 or 2, let's change the notation. I'll write I and F. That will be better. This is UF minus UI, KF minus KI. Now tell me, where are those two points? Final and initial, where are they? Okay, those two, the time is this. This is a scenario right now. Just like in continuity theorem, we have taken scenario at t equal to 0 and scenario at dt time. Same thing we are going to do here. In dt time, whatever happens, or in delta t time, whatever happens, okay, to this entire fluid, that and at t equal to 0, whatever is happening, I am going to connect these two points with Bernoulli theorem. Are you getting it? This entire fluid, listen here again. This entire fluid will move forward like this. Entire fluid will go forward like that. Okay? So I am going to apply Bernoulli theorem at this situation and at that scenario situation. Fine? Right now what is the energy and now what is the energy? Between these two points, the entire fluid moving forward and right now what it is I am going to connect these two things by using Bergman's theorem. Is it clear now? Okay. Now, is there any force that is doing work on this entire fluid? Is there any force, external force on the entire fluid? Gravity is there, understood. But for gravity, you are considering the potential energy. Right? So I will not find out the work done by gravity. Is there any other force other than gravity that is doing work? It is there. Tell me what it is. The force due to the pressure. This pressure is coming from outside, na? This pressure. P1 is outside, this pressure, P2 is outside. Are you getting it? So P1 and P2 can create the external force on this entire fluid. Getting it? Okay. Now suppose in dt time, it moves forward by this much distance, which is how much? V1 dt. And suppose this move forward by V2 dt. Please draw this. Now tell me, work done by the pressure force P1, how much it is equal to? Work done by the force due to P1 pressure is what?
P1
force is how much? Pressure into area. So P1 A1 is the force and displacement is how much? V1 dt. So force into displacement is work done? Yes or no? So force is P1 A1 into the displacement, which is V1 dt. This is the work done by P1 force. Any doubt? And work done by P2 force is how much?
P2 A2 V2 dt.
Now tell me what is wrong with this, the work done by P2 force. Something is wrong.
So it's outside.
So outside to yahan pe, yeah. Both sides it is outside. Something is wrong. See, you can say anything. Anyways, all of you are wrong. So whatever you say, most what will happen, you will be again wrong. Right? So there is something wrong with WP2. Whatever comes in your mind, please comment. Negative. The work done should be negative. Because pressure tries to push it this way. Yes or no? So force due to P2 force will push it that way, but displacement is happening in opposite direction. So work done will be negative, right? Force and displacement are in opposite direction. So total work done, as in work done by the other forces, will be how much? P1 A1 V1 dt minus P2 A2. Any doubt? No doubts? Right? So this is the left hand side of the work energy theorem. Okay? Now let us try to find out. Can I proceed?
Yes.
Let us try to find out the change in potential energy. Final potential energy minus initial potential energy. Okay? What is the final position of the fluid? Final position of fluid is this. A, B, C, D. Are you getting it? So I can divide this entire thing in zones. I can say that this is zone 1, this thing is zone 2, and that thing is zone 3. You'll understand why I'm doing it. It becomes very simple like that. Now tell me, is zone 2 common between initial and final? Zone 2 is common, right? And was zone 3 present initially? No. Was zone 1 present finally? No. Getting it? So let us try to find out UF minus UI it will be equal to potential energy of zone 1 plus potential energy of zone 2 plus potential energy of zone 3, finally minus, I have divided the entire mass into zones, potential energy of zone 1 plus potential energy of zone 2 plus potential energy of zone 3 finally, sorry, initially. Okay, here is the thing, this final potential energy of zone 2 and initial potential of zone 1, zone 2, both are same. Zone 2's initial and final potential energy are same, yes or no? Right? So I can just cancel out this. Zone 2 is common between initial and final. Okay? Initially zone 3 doesn't exist, so this is also gone. And finally zone 1 doesn't exist, that is also gone. Right? What?
So finally zone 1 doesn't exist.
Finally, oh, I have taken this as an initial. Sorry, sorry about that. So finally, zone 1 doesn't exist, so this is final, and initially, zone 3 doesn't exist, so that is initial actually, correct. So this is equal to potential energy of zone 3 minus potential energy of zone 1. Now tell me, how much is the potential energy of zone 3? What is the mass of zone 3? Density into volume, which is how much? A2 into V2 dt. This is mass. MgH is the potential energy. So that into G into what? H2. This is the potential energy of zone 3. Any doubt? Minus potential energy of zone 1, which is how much? Similarly, I can write it as A1 V1 dt into G into dh1. Getting it? Any doubt till now? Please ask. Copy it.
Sir, what you can write that zone 1 doesn't exist in?
See, I am applying Bernoulli theorem on this mass. This mass move forward, there is nothing here now. That is replaced by some other mass, but that is not my system. My system is only this mass, which has moved ahead. I am applying Bernoulli theorem on the mass which was initially present in this much pipe. Is this thing clear? Okay? This one. This is Bernoulli theorem. Work done is U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay? Or zoom in. Here. Yes. This is U2 minus U1. Okay? Alright, now all of you please find out similarly what is KF minus KI. Please find out yourself. You can again divide into zones. Similarly, it will come out like this, kinetic energy of zone 3 minus kinetic energy of zone 1. Okay? It will come out to be like this. Now substitute the values.
Sir,
Anyone done? Half MV square only, right? M is rho into A into A. Okay. So this will be equal to half. M is what? Rho into A1 V1 delta T. This M into V square. Any doubt? Oh, sorry, this is A2. Yeah, correct. Minus of half rho A1 V1, this is dt, I'm taking delta. V1 dt into V1 square. Got it? Understood. Now, I can write continuity equation also here. Yes or no? I can say that A1 V1 equal to A2 V2. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
I can say that. Now, I want you to substitute all of these values in this equation and simplify the terms. All of these, many things will cancel away. A2 V2, A1 V1, and DT, DT, DT everywhere will get cancelled. So try to simplify it and come out with a simple expression. Cancel out A1 V1 and A2 V2, both are same.